Wave hi. Thumbs up. Can you just thumbs up? Good job. All right.
I heard you had a fall this week. Oh, yeah.
Good morning. Oh, yes. It is great to be here. Pena should have never guessed.
Happy birthday, Pena.
All right, you ready? All right, we'll get started this morning. I hope so. We'll see.
All right. Use your teacher voice.
Yeah. I don't have my microphone on me because of NASA, but praise God. We're glad you're here this morning. Hope you're ready to shout and dance, all right? Getting praise the Lord. Shouting and dancing, yeah. Page 56 in the hymnal. To God be the glory, great things he has done. You got to stand up and sing it loud, all right? Sing it loud. 56 in the hymnal.
To God be the glory, great things he has done. So loved he the world that he gave us his son. Who yielded his life in atonement for sin. And open the life gates that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son. And give him the glory, great things he has done. Oh, perfect redemption, the purchase of blood to every believer, the promise of God, the vilest offender who truly believes that moment from Jesus a pardon receives. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son and give him the glory. Great things he has done. Great things he has taught us. Great things he hath done. And great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son. But purer and higher and greater will be our wonder, our transport when Jesus. Hey, let's praise him. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son and give him the glory. Great things he has done.
I don't know about you, but I saw some miracles this past week, some great things he did.
Yes.
Yeah, every day. And today is a great day. Got us up and around, brought us here. Great things. All right, 334, the blood will never, ever, ever lose its power. You got something on your heart today? It can be forgiven. You can have power over it today because of the blood of Jesus.
The blood that on Calvary. The blood that gives me strength from day to day. It will never lose its power when it reaches to the highest mountain. Gives me strength from day to day. It will never lose its power. Soothes my doubts. It soothes my doubt and calms my fears. And it dries all my tears. The blood that gives me strength from day today. It will never lose its power.
Hallelujah!
And it reaches to the highest mountain, and it flows to the lowest valley. Oh, the blood that gives me strength from day to day. It will never lose its power.
Praise God. And then in your white binder, page 30, we call this the Peace Praise. Peace Praise here. If you need something, just grab it over here. Page 30, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. How many are going to run to that today? We run to Him, don't we? And we're protected from all the forces of evil, the darkness. We are protected by the blood.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord, O Most High. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord, O Most High. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. Just run into it, and they are saved. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. Just run into it, and they are saved. Glory to the name of the Lord.
Yeah.
Glory to the name of the Lord. Glory to the name of the Lord.
Tie-dye book, we call it tie-dye, the worship book. It's my tribute. How can I say thanks? How can I say thanks for the things He's done for me? It's page 124 here.
Deserved, yet you give to prove your love for me. The voices of a million angels could not express my gratitude. All that I am and ever hope to be, I owe it all to glory. To God be the glory. Lord Jesus, thank you. With his blood, he has saved me. With his blood, he has raised me. To God be the glory for the things he has done. Just let me live my life. Let it be pleasing, Lord, to thee. And should I gain any praise, let it go to Calvary. With his blood, he has saved me. With his power, hallelujah, he has raised me. To God be the glory for the things he has done.
Yours. To God be the glory.
To God be the glory for the things he has done. With his blood,
oh, he saved us. And with his power, he has raised us.
To God
let's go to the Lord's Prayer. It's on page 631 in the hymnal. 631. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come.
Our Father, which art in heaven,
we ask for your kingdom to come and your will be done. We really do. We think that we can partner with heaven. We can partner with you. And we can see, in the natural, we see the kingdom of darkness operating. We see all the curse that's in this world, and it can be disheartening. But you said, take heart. You overcame, and we are now of the kingdom of light. We are of your kingdom, and we see you move mightily all over, all the time. We don't see how evil it is. We see how good you are, how you're manifesting your goodness and doing great things in our life, and that we can run to at any time and we are safe. We're protected. So, Lord, how can we say thanks today? And we know it's not by words or lip service. It's by giving our heart. It's by truly trusting you with everything that we are, loving you with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength. It's by living this gospel as living sacrifices, holy and acceptable as unto you. That is our reasonable, holy act of worship. And Lord, we didn't come today to just give you a nice lip service. We came to give you our everything, to say you are our God, our Father. So faithful, so true. And we love you. You're the mighty one. And we just rejoice in you this morning. No matter what people have going on in their life today, the grief, sorrow, the stress of this life and world, it's going to roll off in Jesus' name. We think that wherever you are, there's liberty, there's freedom, there's joy. And we receive that right now. We just shout the victory. We're so thankful, Lord. So thankful. Let's just sing Great Is Thy Faithfulness to close.
Great is Thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not, Thy compassions, they fail not. As Thou hast been, Thou forever will be. Great is Thy faithfulness. Great is Thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. And all I have needed, Thy hand hath provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
It's on page 139. Let's do verse 3, because look at the words here. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth, Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide.
Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000.
Oh, thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Great is Thy faithfulness. Great is Thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see.
All I have needed,
has provided.
Welcome you here, Holy Spirit. We say this is your place. We are your people. You have freedom to do whatever you want in this service. We've gathered in your name, in the name of Jesus Christ, to worship you, Father, Dad, in heaven. Thank you for your power that is here today. Salvation, deliverance, hope of the gospel. Right here, right now. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. Amen. Praise God. Amen. That's right. That's right. Praise God. All right, you may be seated. Got a lot of good things to share with you, so we're kind of, I'm going to try to hurry on this, but we got to start off because the birthday is today. We usually don't sing happy birthday in church, but if it's today, we got to do it. It's for Tara. It's her birthday, so can we real quickly sing happy birthday to her? She turned 29 or whatever age it is. It's a wonderful age.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Birthday, dear Tara. Happy birthday to you.
Yeah. Woo. All right. Praise God. Well, we're glad you came and hung out with us on your birthday, you know? What a fun way to celebrate the birthday. Praise the Lord. All right. Lots of announcements here. We sowed a seed into Amy Wisterman, who came last week from RBM Ministries, and she sent us a little card and said, thank you for letting me come share at your church last Sunday. Your kindness and generosity were such an encouragement to me. And then she also said if you'd like to be put on her mailing list so you know all the updates, where she's at, what she's doing, you can send her an email, and I've included that in the announcements there, I believe, so you can contact her. I think I did. Yep, I did. But that was nice. She saw the love of God here, so praise the Lord. our other missionaries, Josh and Crystal Smith, they are settled into up there, Wisconsin. And they're right at the border, so everything worked out. They ran the border, and they didn't have to change their address or anything because they're still in Michigan, technically. Driver's license, that's what it is. But they're they're the last house in Michigan. They're literally the last house in Michigan. And so they are 2 minutes from the church, and they're going to be training there for a year and then going off to wherever the Lord sends them. So what a blessing, and we're part of that. But they were just telling us testimony, miracle after miracle, what God's done. So we're part of that. We're all part of that, and praise God. So their update is on the board over there. It's got their new contact info. Check out that mission board. I try to keep that updated with all everything missions board and contact info and all that kind of stuff. We had a lot of things going on this past month, but God always provides. So praise the Lord. We're doing real well that way. A lot of things happened. The main thing we got is a fence going up around so the kids can play in the back without being caught. There was barbed wire on the side. There was nettles on this side. And we just putting up a fence all the way around. They'll take care of some neighbor stuff and everything. So all working out, but God's helping us and really, really helping us and directing it. So hopefully that happens really soon this week. But that's exciting. So if you come around, you're going to see something going on during the week. I mean, it was neat. We needed some trees trimmed so we could put up the fence. We have some friends that are in the tree business. Well, we called them and they said, actually, we have nothing else going on. Usually we'd have something going on. Our caterpillars in the shop, so we don't have any jobs right now. We'll come. Otherwise, they would not have been able to be available to help us. They came, chopped down a couple trees, and didn't charge us hardly anything. So praise the Lord. Really helped us out. So that's the announcements there. Prayer request. Dawn Wilming, if you remember her, she was a young lady, or lady that was coming. She passed away this past week. And so I don't know any details. She was just, I don't know anything. I'm kind of out of the loop on things there. I don't know the family or anything. But just letting you know, be praying for the family on that. Ben and Angela, they're the young couple we've been praying for in the town. Their dad had an accident and died in the ambulance, came back to life. He's not saved, so let's pray that he gets saved and be praying for that family. And Faye's dad passed away, and so the home going is... Celebration of Life is tomorrow, so because of that, Clean Team will not be tomorrow, okay? Clean Team will be Tuesday at 10, which I noted it there, but I'm sure you're welcome to come, or obviously give your condolences to the family, and she's got the family here with her, so it's a blessing to see them as well, so hearts go out to you guys. Mrs. Savola's home, that is a huge praise. You want to say anything about that?
Yes.
Okay.
God is good. He never leaves us nor forsakes us. I'm home here for a short while, but someday I'm going to be forever home.
Amen.
With my Lord.
Amen.
And we'll all be able to, then I'll be able to jump and somersault. And,
when they said they were sending her to the nursing home for rehab, a lot of times when I hear that, people don't come out of there. They just stick in, they keep you there. And she was a fighter. She did a rehab, and she said, get me out of here. And she's home, praise God. And she's able to get up and around, so praise the Lord. So that's all good stuff. Okay, let's see. Jim and Charlene Longman's anniversary party is at Faye's event center down there. So ask Faye for directions. It's literally brick building right down at the corner. Can't miss it. That'll be today at 2 to 5 for their 70th wedding anniversary. Let's see what else. Monthly reports. So you know every penny that came in, every penny that went out. We are very transparent here as a church. You know everything going on. All the decisions were made, and you know that we're praying about every decision. So a lot of times I'm sharing with you on Sundays before we do something. But it's all in that monthly report. We're going to do a bonfire at the end of the month. Have a missionary coming up. Alternatives is doing a fundraiser for the pro-life ministry if you'd like to be part of that. And Factorville Bible Church, they're having Encounter Revival Ministries. So I'll put up the flyer on there, and you can go if you'd like. That's next week, I believe. Next week. I think that's all the announcements. Oh, we've had people coming and going, doing stuff on the church. Every time they come into this church building, they say, you guys have comfortable chairs here. Praise God what he did. He took us from those hard, hard chairs, and he gave it. So now everybody comes in and says, wow. You know, they're like, I'll sit in the front row here at this church. Praise God. I thought that was cool. Just they were coming in, and I've had that numerous times they said that. Praise the Lord. And also, I wanted to mention, we support Reach the Forgotten Jail Ministry in Kalamazoo. And I passed this around Wednesday. I'll pass it around again. This is somebody who went to jail, got clean and sober, got saved, and now look at the difference. You cannot recognize her from there to here. It's incredible. And we're part of that. We're getting people in the jail to minister to these individuals. So pass this around. I just want you to see the power of the gospel. It changes your body. It changes your face. And again, as working at Teen Challenge Ministries, I saw that. These guys came in, women came in, and they were just gone and nothing to them. And by the time they left, you didn't recognize them because they got born again, saved, the Spirit of God within them, makes them all beautiful, heals them up. And again, we've heard of testimonies of track marks being, just scars being gone and everything. So God makes new people, new creation. Anybody in Christ is a new creation. That's really good. All right, a couple things. Moses wanted to share something. Moses, are you going to come share, buddy? He told me he wanted to preach today. All right, come here, come preach. He said, I said, are you sure? He said he wanted to preach. All right, where's your Bible at? Okay. Okay, what are you going to say? Oh, he wanted to stand. Oh, right. He wanted to be at the pulpit, too. Okay. Okay. What are you going to say? Oh, go to David and Goliath. Okay. David and Goliath was in 127. Okay, go ahead.
Okay, David and Goliath was big. He was giant and really strong. He said, oh, I can go get David for you. And he said, and then he was like that.
And then what did God do? What did David do?
Fought the giant.
And did God win or David win?
David win.
Did God help David win?
Yeah.
That's good. Well, thank you very much for sharing. That was great. Thank you very much. Good job preaching today. Very good, Moses.
Now let's go to...
Oh, you're going to do one more? One more, okay. Go to... Okay, Jesus heals the blind man.
Jesus was healing the blind man that was blind.
And then what happened after Jesus healed him?
He was healed.
Praise God, he could see. Wow. Good job.
Thank you, Moses.
He used his own money to buy this Bible, so he bought the Bible. Oh, it's too good. All right, praise God. I love this. You know, I love when we can have foster that kind of, you know, thing where kids can learn to, God here talks to them too, so. All right, since Steve is here, Denise, do you want to do your song now? Where's Denise? You ready to do your song then, since Steve's here? We want to make sure you are here. All right. We have special music today. This will be fun. So Denise and Gene are kind of flipping back and forth, taking turns for us. And so we get Gene next week, but Denise has got a really special song this week.
Can I say something?
Absolutely.
So the song is called My Let Me Tell You About My Jesus, or it's called My Jesus. And so sometimes we can see what's happening when we, you know, talk about Jesus, and we can see the fruit of that. And sometimes there's seeds that are planted that we don't know. We don't know what the outcome is. And I was reminded this week, there was a student that I had for driver's ed, and through talking through that, found out that family was related to this woman that used to be our playground supervisor, Grandma Messer. I don't know if you remember Grandma Messer, a couple of Toby kids back here. And sometimes school's not the funnest place to be, and a lot of bullying and stuff. And Grandma Messer would always, and of course this is the 70s, so you could kind of say, you know, I'll pray for you, or you could say something about God without, you know, getting fired. And but I didn't know about Jesus. I didn't come from a Christian home. But I remember Grandma Messer, you know, just, you know, hugging me in her arms and telling me that, you know, she loved me and that Jesus loved me and that she'd pray for me. And then she, you know, I'd come back and I'd tell her what had happened. And so I didn't realize then how much, you know, she was planting seeds in me that would later come from, you know, the people that really led me to Jesus. So it was just kind of a nice reminder this week of doing this song that I was, you know, reunited with that family, that we were all connected. So we can all be out there telling everybody about our Jesus. Are you past the point of weary? Is your burden weighing heavy? Is it all too much to carry? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Do you feel that empty feeling? The shame's done all it's stealing, and you're desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way. rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. And let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah, 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 amen, amen. Tears and broken dreams and wasted years until the past to disappear. Oh, let me tell you about my Jesus and all the wrong turns that you would go and undo if you could. Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is free and faith is free. The good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus, and let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah, 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 amen, amen. Who would take my cross to Calvary, be the price for all my guilty? Who would care that much about me? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Oh, he makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up on an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus, and let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah, 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 amen, amen, amen. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Let my Jesus change your life.
Sorry for Hadassah jumping behind you.
Oh, no, she's great.
That was really good. All right. Praise God. How he can change your life. Jesus Christ can change your life.
Amen.
Totally transform your life. Take it from death to life just by giving your life to him. He does it. All right, before we, let's hold off on offering. Let's do communion right now. Communion's open to anybody who's born again. If you're saved, child of God, you can take communion here. We're not, you know, some churches, if you're not part of their church, if you're part of the Church of Jesus Christ, you're good, okay? But so as long as you're with the, walking with the Lord and been born again, and want to thinking of some scripture here that, where it talks about how Jesus poured out that blood for you and I in the sacrifice. You know, again, if you were Jewish, you understood the significance of the Passover and the feast and all these type of things. But when Jesus did this, it was just a, it was going to totally transform everything by this one act of giving up his life. It wasn't, you know, many people have died. Many good people have been killed or murdered or martyred. But Jesus Christ, he was the Son of God. And when he gave up his own life, that was the propitiation, the sacrifice for you and I, for our sins. And so we can be forgiven because of that. And where Jesus had the Passover and he says, this is my blood. This is the new covenant. And that's what we get to partake in today. Usually we come up here and while we play some music, we're going to do it a little bit differently. So if you'd open in your hymnal, and again, you probably won't have hands to be able to do everything, but that's all right. But just so you can sing along, we will be singing 497, I Will Praise Him, and then 302, while we do the communion. And what we're going to do, if I can, I didn't ask them before, but is it all right if Matt and Amanda and Israel and Tara come help me out? And if you guys will divvy all this out, pass it out for us, and then hold on to it. We'll all take it together, okay? Today we're going to do it differently. Hold on to your bread and your juice, and we'll take it together, okay? And while we sing, I Will Praise Him, 497. So however you guys want to work it. Just,
yeah, I've never done this before.
Just doesn't matter. I just need a bunch of hands. I think there's only one bread, but you guys can pass it back and forth or however you want to do it.
Okay,
497. Let's... When I saw the cleansing fountain open wide for all my sin, I obeyed the Spirit's wooing when He said, "Wilt thou be clean?" I will praise Him. I will praise Him. Praise the Lamb for sinners slain. Give Him glory, all ye people, for His blood can wash away each stain. Though the way seems straight and narrow, all I claimed was swept away. My ambitious plans and wishes at the time of this I will praise Him. For His blood can wash away each stain. Go ahead and get yours too. Blessed be the name of Jesus, and I'm so glad He took me in. He has cleansed my passions. He has cleansed my heart from sin. I will praise Him. I will praise Him. Praise the Lamb for sinners slain. Give Him glory, all ye people, for His blood can wash away each stain. We thank You that wash us from every stain and every part of the sin curse. Saved completely. Lord, today we give You our sin. We are sorry for the times we gossiped and slandered or lied or whatever sin it was. It may have been even this week we slipped and messed up a few times. Lord, we thank You that we can come to You for forgiveness. And we say forgive us, Lord. We ask for a pure heart. Clean conscience, where the enemy has nothing over us because we're righteous and just. We're redeemed. So, Lord, we thank You for Your body, for Your blood. We give You our life. And You said that this is Your body broken for us. Let's hold the bread. And I have faith in the body of the Lamb of God. You bore my sickness. You carried my pains in Your own body on the tree. And I believe that I receive the full benefits of the body of Christ. Let's break and eat. Lord, with Your blood, You sealed the covenant. It was a forever done deal. You can never go back on it. You, Jesus, gave up your life in the flesh. Laid it down so you could be the author and finisher of our faith. We thank you for buying our life with your blood. You bought us. We are no longer our own. We are yours. Any problems that come up in our life, we have victory over it. Any obstacles, any stumbling blocks, any trials, we have victory because the blood has been shed. We have faith in the blood of the spotless Lamb of God. Your blood redeemed us. Your blood washed us from all sin, from all shame and unrighteousness. And we thank you for salvation, that we're clean, we're accepted, we're a child of yours, child of God now because of the blood. Let's take and drink. Thank you, Lord. Oh, isn't that wonderful? So if you got anything in your life or body, receive God's mercy right now, healing from it. A covenant has been shed, you just partook of his body. You just partook of that, and you have joint access. You're a joint heir with Christ Jesus. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Okay. Thank you for helping with the communion. Appreciate that. All right. We're going to take up our tithes and offerings this morning. Got a couple scriptures here for this. I'm going to read you a couple of them. Usually I just find one scripture to read, but the Lord gave me a couple of them, so I'm going to read them. Mark chapter 12. Remember the says Mark 12, verse 41, let's start with. Says, and he sat down opposite the treasury and began to observing how the people were putting money into the treasury. And many rich people were putting in large sums. A poor widow came and put in two small copper coins, which amount to a cent. Calling his disciples to him, he said to them, truly I say to you, this poor widow put in more than all the contributions to the treasury. For they all put in out of their surplus, but she, out of her poverty, put all she owned, all that she had to live on. So you say, I don't have much to give or anything like that. God, look, it's not about how much. You can have somebody that gives 2 pennies gave more than somebody that gave 2,000 because it's based on the heart and the percentage. And so that's the beauty of it. We all come here today saying, Lord, we trust you with our finances. You've blessed us, and everything we have is from you. It's just, it's God's way of looking at things is so different. And I've shared the story of how I heard where, you know, somebody left the church and the pastor's like, Lord, that was my biggest giver. You know, what's going to happen now? And God said, I didn't leave the church. I didn't go anywhere, you know. It's not dependent on man. God can use those that don't have much, and he turns it and multiplies it. And so whatever little you do have, God can multiply. And he sees it as great value. And he wants to bless you. The other scripture I wanted to read for you was Exodus 36. The Lord gave me this one this past week too for this. And I'm taking, we take time with this because this is holy. Exodus 36, it says, they're working on the house of God. And it says in verse 2, Exodus 36, 2. Then Moses called Bezalel and Oholiab, and every skillful person whom the Spirit had put skill, everyone whose heart stirred him, to come to work to perform it. They received from Moses all the contributions which the sons of Israel brought to perform the work in the construction of the sanctuary, and they still continued bringing to him free will offerings every morning. And all the skillful men who were performing all the work of the sanctuary came, each from the work which he was performing. And they said to Moses, the people are bringing much more than enough for the construction work which the Lord commanded us to perform. So Moses issued a command, and the proclamation was circulated throughout the camp, saying, let no man or woman any longer perform work for the contribution of the sanctuary. Thus the people were restrained from bringing any more, for the material they had was sufficient and more than enough for all the work to perform it. So every time we've said we want to do, you know, the Lord's doing something here at this church, there has always been more than enough. You'll always hear a good report. You'll never hear begging for money from the church or trying to manipulate money from anybody. There's always more than enough because God moves on people's hearts. It's free will. It's free will you come and give. And there's always going to be more than enough. And so God is just doing big things. I keep hearing myself say over and over, God's doing big things here, great things. And God is really doing that. And that means in our own life. Seen somebody was sharing some other financial testimonies this past week. That's who it was. Wednesday night, somebody shared. They had thousands of dollars somehow given to them just recently. It came into $1,000, and they paid off all their credit cards. Now, they still have house and cars, but just in one night, they went from that to all of a sudden being no credit cards. God's doing that kind of stuff here. And so I just want you to be able to know that, you know, you're not giving to a church. This is partnering with God, and he's the one that rewards on that. And I just want you to enjoy giving. The last one is number 6. This is where they bless the people. And Numbers chapter 6, verse 22. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, speak to Aaron and to his sons, saying, thus you shall bless the sons of Israel. You shall say to them, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance on you and give you his peace. So they shall invoke my name on the sons of Israel, and I then will bless them. So I release that blessing over you today. I release that blessing that the Lord is watching over you. He's blessing you. Lord, as you're under shepherds by the anointing and by the authority in Jesus Christ, Lord, I would just speak over your people, and I say that they'd be increased in the name of Jesus. May they rise up higher, advance farther in every good thing. May they come out of debt and have abundance. May the enemy not be able to steal from them. And may your blessing, Lord, and the goodness of you be seen on and in their life until others are drawn to you because of it. And we just thank you in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. All right, have fun giving. Have fun giving. Who's taking up our offering? Usually the kiddos do this one. Naomi, this one's yours. All right, have fun giving. Praise the Lord. All right. Praise God. Anybody want to share just a quick testimony of what God did for you this week? I wrote something on Facebook. I can share it if nobody else shares. But anybody else see a miracle happen this past week? Some real testimonies. Yes.
Other.
Praise the Lord.
To be able to do all the work that we needed to do and get done and safe travels. And I can't thank this church enough for your prayers.
Praise God.
Because God has answered everyone and more. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you.
Praise God. Anybody else? What God did for you.
The Lord. I've been looking for a church to come to. And my sister-in-law and nephew showed me the way to this church. I've been looking church for about 5-6 months or longer because I wasn't happy where I was, but now I feel the Lord here.
Praise the Lord.
I want to praise the Lord. I can praise him now.
Amen. 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 Wow. That's so neat. That's so neat. Thank you, Lord. What a blessing. Anybody else? Yeah.
We had a surprise. We came home from, we've had several blessings this week, so this is just one of them. We got home and there was a gift certificate for an online store to get something for the kids and a coupon for money off. So we were able to get a jacket, a new pair of shoes and jeans. And each of the kids was saying, this is something I've been praying about. This is something that I want to
do.
And
nice.
Just God did it. And so you pray about things. And then I had somebody who several months ago said, I have a warmer sweatshirt for you. And the one that I had, my zipper had broken, and here it showed up on our doorstep this week, too. And it was just one of those reminders of God's faithfulness, his provision, his hand in everything. So it was really neat.
And we want this to be a safe place where people know you're not bragging, you're not boasting and saying, look at me, it's just giving God all the glory because he does these things for your people, for us as his people. So don't ever feel like, you know, it's hard for me even to share because I don't want you to think it's all about me. I'm seeing things every day. I hope you are, too. I wrote it on Facebook, some things, just somebody pulling in the driveway saying, here's a $100 bill. We had that. We had somebody, she got a side job of playing the piano, and we didn't have enough money to pay a utility bill. After tithing, she got some money for that playing at a funeral. We had enough money to pay the utility bill and $1 left over. So God is so good. I mean, just so, so good. Yeah, God is just so good. So that's what we want to believe, just tell you, God is doing good things for you. In your own personal life. It's not just the church building and all this. He's doing good things in your life because we are the church. He's moving. People are getting out of debt, and it's just a beautiful thing. All right, let's do one or two songs before I let the kids be dismissed here. So hard to pick because they're all such good songs. Let's, we'll just see. We'll start at the 42 in the Peace Praise. Hosanna to the Lamb that was slain. Well, this is kind of a new one, I think, but that's all right. Thank you. Page 42 in the Peace Praise. Hosanna to the Lamb that was slain. It's on the right-hand top. Let the weak say I'm strong. Let's do it today. Let's say we're strong. Because of what the Lord has done in me. Hallelujah.
Let the weak say I am strong. Let the poor say I am rich. Let the blind say, I can see. It's what the Lord has done in me. Let the weak say, I am strong. Hallelujah. Let the poor say, I am rich. Let the blind say, I can see. It's what the Lord has done for me. Hosanna, oh, Hosanna to the Lamb that was slain. Hosanna, Hosanna, Jesus died and rose again. There my sins are washed away from the heavens. Mercy streams, the Savior's love for me.
Goodness of God, page 8 in the Peace Praise. Page 8, the goodness of God. We're going to talk a little bit about that today. Your mercy never fails.
For your mercy never fails me.
We have everything in your grace. We have everything in everything with your salvation. Full, complete deal. It's finished. It's covered. It's done deal. You are the great I am. You are exactly what we need for every situation. You have exactly everything we need for everything we face. You're El Shaddai. The Almighty, the Most High God. No other God, none other. You are the one, the true, the only God. The way, the truth, and the life. That we can come to you, Father, because of what Jesus did for us. We just are so thankful for your love for us. Because it's unmerited. We don't deserve it. We haven't done nothing to earn it. We can't work for it. We can't do anything except receive it. Believe it and receive it. And we do. We believe it. We have come to know the love that you have for us. We have come to know and to believe the love you have for us. And we still at times think, how can you love us? How can you put up with us every day when we sometimes grumble and complain or get doubts or lose sight? And yet every time, Holy Spirit, you're right there to put our eyes back on Jesus. To help us. We're so thankful, Holy Spirit, for helping us. Lord, I don't know what your people need today. I don't know what they need to hear. I don't know what they're asking and believing for, but Lord, I think that you know and you are here. And you know how to minister to every single need in this room, whatever it is. And we have come to get in your presence today and say, Lord, transform us. Maybe we got some condemnation or shame. Lord, let that break off right now in Jesus' name. Let us walk just with our head held high, knowing that we are forgiven. It's gone. It's forgiven. It's done. It's over. There's grace. There's mercy. Lord, we thank you for repentance, that we can turn from that sin by the power of the Holy Spirit. Deliverance from it. Freedom from it. We're not walking according to our own self-righteousness. We thank you for the righteousness that you give us. Let's finish with Sweet Hour of Prayer.
Sweet Hour of Prayer, Sweet Hour of Prayer, that bids me come up here and bids me
know this is a holy moment right now. I thank you for these holy times. It's a time, this is a house of prayer, and we have come to give you our everything, to lift you up, Jesus. Open our eyes to your word today. Let us see things we've never seen before. Let us hear words of life and answers and solutions come and direction for our life and how to handle situations, that we'll have that unction of the Spirit, that confirmation. Maybe we're believing for something, we need confirmation or a witness. Let us get it today from your word. In Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Thanks for helping sing that song. It just came to me, but then I didn't know it all. I just knew the Sweet Hour of Prayer. All right, girl, you can go. You want to go to kids' class? Say bye to everybody.
Bye.
There you go.
Bye.
Bye. Bye-bye. Okay. Thank you, Lord. I'm going to talk a little bit about some stuff that we've kind of talked about in the past, but I just want to bring it out again. And again, we're thankful for when people come to Clean Team. This week will be Tuesday because we always are picking up Cheerios and pretzels off the floor. It's always, there's always something to find at Clean Team when you're a cleaner. All right. Praise the Lord. We had a lot going on today. This is wonderful. Special music, communion, it's all been good. But we want to get into the Word of God, and I'm thankful for what Pastor encouraged us last week to say, make sure we get in our Bibles. And so if you need a Bible, they're back there. If you need one to follow along, your phone, I know phone's got it, and what a blessing. If you'll turn in your Bibles to John chapter 1,
John chapter 1, okay? Praise God. Now again, get in the Word of God every day. Whether it's a couple chapters or a couple verses, just get in the Word and let this be your good news for the day. Okay? The newspaper ain't going to give you any good news, but this will give you a good news. You don't need no horoscope to tell your future. You have the Word of God. Okay? The Word of God is what we go by, and this is our life. And so enjoy getting in the prayer closet every day. Don't, you know, sometimes it's like, well, okay, fine, I got to do it, you know. But really, you get in there, and it's just, Jesus is wonderful. He just starts opening your eyes, and you see things, and it's like comfort and encouragement comes, and it's a blessing. It says in John 1:14, and Wednesday nights we're actually doing John, looking through the book of John, so come on out on Wednesdays. But it says, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we saw his glory. Glory as of the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth. Skip down to verse 17. For the law was given through Moses, grace and truth were realized through Jesus Christ. Now, we've talked some about this, but the Lord brought it back to me. Religion has brought a lot of shame on people. You try to shame people into getting saved, or how, you know, shame on you. And we've talked about how it's the goodness of God that draws us to repentance. It's when we realize God loves us and his goodness, it's not just shame on you, it's a matter of he will wash away that shame. You don't have to be so fearful to come before God. He says, come, come, and I'll heal you, I'll forgive you, I'll come, you know. So we don't want to be just shame. We got Jesus, and he's grace and truth. Now, again, we don't abuse that grace. We're not hype, you know. Some people say, well, I can live in sin because I'm under grace. And Romans says, no, no, no. And we know that's not a true thing. We live in a culture now, right now, where they want their safe place, where they, you know, feel safe, and everybody agrees with them, and it's kind of really childish. But the Lord said, I want my people in my grace place. Because when we're in our grace place, then we're free from the shame, and we're able to just love on Jesus, and we get to walk with him. And so let's be in our grace place. But the Lord showed me some things this past week, and I wanted to share it with you. What grace does in our life, okay? Grace will build us up, and I'll show you all this through the scripture, okay? It will help us deny ourselves and deny sin. It's God's grace that gives us the ability to turn from sin and say no to it. It's the power over it. It's God's grace that helps us to say yes to him and no to the temptation. Grace will help us to defeat the devil. If you want to run off the devil, it's not by shame. It's not by, because the devil brings condemnation, doesn't he? In the church world, sometimes we have made it where we shame and condemn people. You had a divorce, you had a baby out of wedlock, and all these different things. We've stereotyped and pushed people away because of that whatever. And really, it should be Jesus welcomed people and said, hey, I'll change you. Just come to me as you are, and I'll change you. And so, you know, we can come, go to him. And then we can help, we can finish strong, okay? Grace will preserve us. If you get out of God's grace, then you're going based on your own gifting, your own abilities. A lot of times we can be deceived and think, I'm good with God, I'm good. And yet we realize we're depending too much on ourselves. And he sometimes has to pull back and say, are you really trusting me? You know, grace will help us to preserve us and keep us going strong. Now I want you to see this scripturally. And we're going to look at some scripture here. Acts chapter 20. So grace and truth are with Jesus, not religion. Religion will not save us. Only Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. He brings salvation to us. When we repent of our sin, ask him to come into our life, he does it. Okay? Now again, you must be born again. Jesus said, you cannot get to the Father unless you're born again. I hope everybody in this room has become born again. If not, you can be. It's wonderful. It's really wonderful. You go from death to life, and it's amazing. It's not tradition, it's not religion, it's Jesus. Acts chapter 20, verse 32. It says, now he's talking to the churches here. Okay, he's building churches here, Paul. And it says, and now I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you the inheritance among those who are sanctified. Religion never builds people up. It always puts them down. It always puts them down. Where here he says, I'm giving it over to the word of grace. This word of grace is God's unmerited favor and his love. And that grace will build you up in the faith. It won't tear you down and say, how horrible a person you are. I can't believe you did that. Grace just says, hey, I love you. Gives you a big hug and says, let's get back on the right track. It's forgiving that sin and going forward. But he says, grace is actually what builds us up. If you get out of grace, you're not going to be built up anymore, because you have to be hooked to Jesus, abiding in Christ. And it's his grace, realizing that he loves you, realizing he's He's not angry or mad at you, but he'll forgive you. You know, he hates the sin. He hates the sin. But the moment you repent, it's gone. He loves you. And so it will build us up. And it says, give you the inheritance. So if you want to know the kingdom of God and you want to enjoy the kingdom of God, you have to go, you believe, you know, by grace we are saved through faith, and that not of ourselves, it's a gift of God, lest any man should boast. So we have to realize it's God's grace that lets us to partake of the kingdom. We're not partaking of the kingdom because we're good enough, because we're self-righteous, because we go to church. It's none of those things. It's not based on any of that. It's based on his grace to us, and we just receive and say, yes, Lord. All the promises of God are yes and amen in Christ Jesus. We say, yes, Lord, we believe, and amen. You know. So it says, he says, I'm commending you. I'm putting you in protective care to God in the word of his grace, which is the message of grace. It's the counsel and promises of favor. When you know you have promises of God's favor on your life, that builds you up. But if you're dealing with religion and all that, it will shame you and it will put you down. Okay, you did this, and you can never change, and you're always going to be marked by that, and you're disqualified, you're, you know, these type of things. And Jesus says, I qualify you. I'll change it. Now, it says in Hebrews chapter 3, it says the same thing, but I want you to see this in Hebrews 13, it says it here twice where it says grace builds us up. And I want you to be built up today, knowing that God loves you, he cares about you. Maybe you missed it this week or whatever, but he's got you. You just turn to him and he'll forgive it and get you back on track. Hebrews 13, verse 9. Okay, Hebrews 13, verse 9. Now he's talking about legalism, okay? Religion, legalism. We're talking about the law. The law does this, okay? It says in verse 9, do not be carried away by varied and strange teachings, for it's good for the heart to be strengthened by grace, not by foods through which those who are so occupied were not benefited. And he goes on to talk about how we're part of the true worship and the altar of God. They had, the religious people were under such legalism, which brings shame, right? Because you never measure up. You'll never measure up under the law, okay? But Jesus delivered us from that. He completed and fulfilled the law for you and I. So now we're, the shame is gone. And he says here in the scripture, right here, it says, we're strengthened by grace, not by all these external things. Not by, if you dress the right way for church, not if you do all these things, you're saved. It's the heart that's strengthened by grace, because religion's made it where you got to follow all these rules, and then that's no fun. Nobody's fun and having the praise of the Lord and dancing. Why? Because it's just rules. As where Jesus says, I'll strengthen you by my grace. My grace will give you strength to shout the victory and say, I'm forgiven, I love the Lord. It sets you free to worship when you're walking in grace. But your heart today might need strengthened from grace. It won't come from trying to be a good person, doing all these things. It's through the blood of Jesus and the grace of God on your life. And he says here that your heart to be strengthened by grace, not by all these external things, not by legalism. Isn't that wonderful? God wants to build us up and strengthen us today. He's not looking to tear you down. He's not looking to condemn you and say, you did that again. Come on. He'll just say, you did it again, but I got you. We're going to get it next time. There's that redemptive thing that I'm not going to let you stay in that sin. You're going to beat it. We're going to beat it together. I'm here with you, and we're going to beat this thing. It's him saying, I will go through this with you. Now, it bothers me because I've seen in, you look in the Old Testament, well, you look at two people, and the Spirit of God left them, and they didn't even know it. You look at Samson, right? He didn't even know the Spirit of God left him. He got up, and he thinks, I'm going to depend on my own gifting. I've got it just like normal. And it says the Spirit, the Lord had departed from him, and he didn't even know it. And then Saul, remember Saul? He started raving mad and wanted to kill David. And it said the Spirit of the Lord departed from Saul. Here was men who were walking in religion, walking in, you know, their own self-righteousness type thing. And when the Spirit of God left, then they were left naked. They didn't realize that it was like, it was really God doing all these things. And now they were stuck to their own devices. And I think what happens is whenever we get out of grace, then we're left to our own devices. And there'll be certain times where we realize what's going on. And God says, I stepped back. Not that God turned his back on us, but he just said, I can't bless you until you acknowledge my grace and get this right. So it's our part to be the prodigal and come back and say, Lord, I need your grace in my life. We need this grace because I'm going to miss it without you. And we don't want the Spirit of God. I was looking at the prayer of David. He said, do not cast me away from your presence. Do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Now, we know the Holy Spirit won't leave us. We're so thankful the Holy Spirit's dwelling within us. But there are certain times where if we're walking in sin and we're trying to do it on our own strength, it'll say, Okay, let me know when you're ready for me to jump back in here and help you out. Let me know when you're ready for my grace to help you. And when we realize, yeah, I need that grace, Lord, bring it back. And the Spirit of God just brings new life and builds us back up again. Because there's been times where I messed up so bad and I felt worthless and horrible. And, you know, and I just, Lord, can you forgive me? And that was condemning. It just put me down. And then when you hear the Lord say, I forgive you. Oh, your heart just soars, you know. I got you. Next time you'll do better. He's so gracious and patient with us, so long-suffering. And he doesn't want you living in shame. I'm telling you right now, get out of any shame in your life and just get in the grace, please. Now, where I want to go now is it says in Titus chapter 2, Titus chapter 2, and I know I'm not going to be able to get through all this, but that's fine. Titus chapter 2. So, got to go back a little bit for Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, 1 Thessalonians, 1 Timothy, Titus. Right after 2 Timothy, it's a tiny little book. Titus chapter 2, verse 11. Okay. Now, again, if people think I can live in sin because I'm under grace, we know that's Romans says it's wrong, but also here it says, verse 11, Titus 2, verse 11. For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all men, instructing us to deny ungodliness and worldly desires and to live sensibly, righteously, and godly in this present age, looking for the blessed hope and the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Christ Jesus, who gave himself for us to redeem us from every lawless deed and to purify for himself a people for his own possession, zealous for good deeds. So it's God's grace that will help us to deny ungodliness and worldly desires. It's actually God's grace that makes you say, I don't want to do that. I want to serve him. I don't want to give in to the temptation. It's God's grace where he says, I will give you the strength to say no to the wrong thing. It's God's grace to say, I forgive you this time, next time we're going to do it. It's grace of God that brings salvation, but that grace teaches us some things. It instructs us, and you've got to deny some things. And it's either you deny the flesh, deny yourself, right? Take up your cross and follow him. Or it says in other places you end up denying him. We don't want to deny him. We don't want to deny the Lord. In Jude chapter 1, it says they turn the grace of God into licentiousness. That's a big word there. And deny the only master. Whenever you turn God's grace into a license to sin, then you've just denied him. I'd rather deny myself and take up my cross than deny him, right? Amen? We need to really be sure that we're denying the flesh and denying ungodliness and worldly desires. And how are we going to live then in this world with grace of God? Sensibly, which would be wisdom. Self-controlled, which would be righteously. We're self-controlled, we're upright. We live lives with purpose and growing in maturity. Godly, it would be devotion to God in this present age. And we're looking for that blessed hope. We're looking forward to him coming, that we want to be found by him, spotless, pure, holy, blameless, because he's come back for the bride of, you know, his bride. They'll be holy and spotless. That we are walking in the ways of him and doing what he called us to do. That's the grace of God. Grace of God helps you say no. It doesn't just condemn you for messing up. It says, I will help you. That's God's grace. And I'm thankful we're not fighting it on our own, aren't you? Real thankful. There were some things on my mind this week, and I'm like, Lord, I'm thankful you're helping me. Fighting it for me. Give me the strength. 1 Peter chapter 5. Well, I'm not sure how far we'll get, but I want to give you at least going as far as I can today. 1 Peter chapter 5. So just go a couple pages over, and you'll be after James. You got 1 Peter chapter 5. It's God's grace that will help you fight the devil. If you're fighting him on your own strength, you'll lose. Willpower will not do it. You cannot take the devil on by your own strength. You need God's grace helping you fight this daily life. Good fight of faith. It's wonderful. It's amazing. You have victory over the devil because of the grace of God. It says in 1 Peter 5, verse 5. Okay? 1 Peter 5, verse 5. It says, you younger men, likewise be subject to your elders, and all of you clothe yourselves with humility toward one another, for God is opposed to the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you at the proper time. That's talking about building you up. He's going to, as you cast your cares on him, he's going to build you up. Casting all your anxiety on him because he cares for you. Be of sober spirit. Be on the alert. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. But resist him, firm in your faith, knowing that the same experiences of suffering are being accomplished by your brethren who are in the world. And after you've suffered for a little while, the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself perfect, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. To him be the dominion forever and ever. Amen. Through Salvanius, our faithful brother, for so I regard him, I've written to you briefly, exhorting and testifying that this is the true grace of God. Stand firm in it. Stand firm in it. So he says here, if you're going to take on the enemy, you're going to need the grace of God. Stand firm in God's grace. Stand firm in faith, firm in faith, and stand firm in God's grace. And when you have faith in God's grace, you can say no to the devil. He comes around and saying, I'm going to tear you apart. I'm going to devour you. I'm going to get you to fall into temptation and sin and whatever. And you can say, you may not devour me. You may not. I'm not a straggler at the back behind the pack. I'm with my shepherd. I'm right next to my shepherd. You can't touch me. Nah, 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 nah. You know? Yeah, it's wonderful. It's wonderful. He comes to look to spoil your day, and one thing, you think, oh, my day's ruined. He's like, no, it ain't. That ain't ruined at all. It's going to get better and better. So the enemy wants to come in and take you out, but it's actually the God of all grace who's called you to himself, and he says, this is God's grace. Stand in it now. Where you're resisting the enemy and the things coming on, you're standing firm. You realize that you're not alone and by yourself. Other Christians are encountering some things in their life too. You're not the only one. Whenever you get to think, I'm the only one, God, and I'm all alone. No, we all face the same stuff, the same things. It says grace. But look at what it does. There's four things it does, and this is building us up. You say, Lord, help me. Give me your grace. He'll perfect you, which means he'll complete you. He'll restore you, okay? He'll confirm you, and he'll affirm you and say, this one's mine. You're mine. I love you. I've got you. He'll strengthen you, which would be support you. He'll say, I've got you. I'm carrying you. That's strengthen. And he'll establish you. He'll make you what you make you strong. He'll place you on a firm foundation. You'll be steadfast. Instead of being tossed here and there, you'll be like, I'm in the grace of God, and I'm stronger than ever. Because I'm not depending on my own strength. It's just God's grace. I got knocked down. I'm right back up. You know, when you're trying to get free from sin, what happens is you get knocked down. You figure, well, I tried, so I might as well give up now. I'm ruined. I tried. And God's grace says, get back up. I got you. Come on. Let's do this again. You know, it's always saying, instead of you messed up, it's saying, I love you anyways. And I've seen it where, again, you want to get people saved. It's not by condemning them. Condemnation, bringing shame on them will not say, oh, yeah, I want that God. It's saying, you're in sin, but God loves you so much, he'll forgive you. It's presenting the bad news that with the wages of sin is death. Wages of sin is death. God does not excuse sin. You got to get free of it. You got to get saved, forgiven. But he's got grace on your life, and he will totally take you in. So when we see people that are doing crazy stuff and they're living it immoral and all this, we just have to give them the love of God and say, God wants to save you. He wants to forgive you. Give your life to him. You know, it's God's grace because they think they're worthless. They think they're hopeless. I've made a mess of my life, and I never go. I'm beyond God's hope, or you know, I'm beyond hope. You say, no, no, no. There is a grace place to be. You're looking for a safe place, and you're looking for security and safety in a lover and alcohol. You're looking for comfort and satisfaction where there's death. How about you go to where Jesus is, where grace and truth. Grace and truth is found in Jesus. You look at the kingdom of Jesus, the prostitutes, the tax collectors, the cheats. They love Jesus. Who had a problem with Jesus? It was the religious people. Because the religious people wanted to put people down instead of saying God wants to build you up your life and fix your life and put you on a firm foundation, the foundation of Christ Jesus being the foundation. Radical transformation. That's what it's about right there. But if the enemy's coming your way, just stand firm in the faith. Say, you're not taking me out. He's roaring. Sometimes he's just all roar. And just let that roar. It doesn't scare you. And you know you're protected. Why? Because you're humble. You're placing yourself under the mighty hand of God. And he's the one that's going to exalt you. Okay? Where I want to finish today, I think, is a couple other spots here. Let's go to 2 Timothy chapter 3, I think. Lord, give me a couple things here. I'm trying to figure out how to finish this. 2 Timothy chapter 3. Okay. So, some of the things we got to deny so we can experience the grace of God, we've got to love the Lord with all the heart, mind, soul, and strength. 2 Timothy chapter 3, okay, verse 1. Now, it doesn't really say the grace of God here, but it talks about giving us power to have the knowledge of the truth and to live in the faith. It says in 2 Timothy chapter 3, but realize this, that in the last days, difficult times will come. For men will be lovers of self, lovers of money, boastful, arrogant, revilers, disobedient to parents, ungrateful, unholy, unloving, irreconcilable, malicious gossips, without self-control, brutal, haters of good, treacherous, reckless, conceited, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, holding to a form of godliness, although they've denied its power. Avoid such men as these, for among them are those who enter into households and captivate weak women, weighed down with sins, led on by various impulses, always learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Just as Jannes and Jambres opposed Moses, so these men also oppose the truth, men of depraved mind rejected in regard to the truth. But they will not make further progress, for their folly will be obvious to all, just as Jannes and Jambres' folly was also. Now you followed my teaching, my conduct, my purpose, faith, patience, love, perseverance, persecutions, and sufferings, such as happened to me at Antioch and Iconium and Lystra. What persecutions I endured, and out of them all, not some, not a few, out of them all the Lord rescued me. Indeed, all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. But evil men and impostors will proceed from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. You, however, continue in the things you have learned and become convinced of, knowing from whom you have learned them, and that from childhood you've known the sacred writings, which are able to give you the wisdom that leads to salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. All scripture is inspired by God and is profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be adequate, equipped for every good work. There's people that have a form of godliness, but they deny the power because they're not walking in the grace of God. They're walking on their own self-righteousness. And we don't want that. But he says they're lovers of self, lovers of pleasure, and all these different things. And he says, that's not for you and I. That's not for you and I at all. He says, follow my teaching, my conduct, my purpose, faith, patience, love, perseverance. How has the Lord taught us to walk in this life? Is it by doing things our own way and doing our whatever we think is best, or doing it his way? Doing it his way. We follow him. We conduct our life according to his will. And that's the grace of God that helps us do that. It's the grace of God that says, Lord, I desire to walk according to your ways, to keep persevering, to keep loving you, keep walking in faith when it looks like nothing's happening, to have patience. And it's by your word. The word of God will give you grace. It's remember the word of his grace, it said? Remember that it said? The word of his grace? This right here is the word of his grace, given to you so you'll be adequate, equipped for every good work. You're strengthened in the faith. Look at these things. You've been taught, you've learned and convinced, verse 14. You, however, continue the things you have learned and become convinced of, knowing from whom you have learned them. He's saying you have learned and you're convinced that this is truth. This is the grace of God. And so let your life show that. And that's what we want. We don't want to be stuck in a form of godliness because we're denying its power. We want to live the gospel. We want to walk out of shame into the gospel. That's where Jesus comes in. Get in that place where you and Jesus, and you say, Lord, I'm struggling with this in my life. Help me out. Whatever you bring to the Lord, there's grace there on it now. If you hide it, if you keep it, and try to wrestle with it yourself, you're left to your own. But whenever you bring it to him, he says, I will help you. I will help you. I've got the grace to help you, strengthen you. Four things that we just looked at. Grace will build you up. It'll help you deny yourself and sin. You'll be able to defeat the devil, and you'll be able to finish strong. He'll preserve you. That's the grace place you want to be. So if you've got anything from your past where religion has brought shame or sin has brought shame, take it to him. Take it to Jesus. It'll be dealt with today. Don't carry it around. Don't carry it around. Don't carry it around for another minute. You say, I hurt somebody, and I feel so bad for it. I feel so guilty. Or they hurt me. Just get in the place where there's grace and truth. Truth says, yeah, you messed up. Yeah, you're a sinner, but I love you and I'll forgive you. Grace says, the truth is, you don't deserve it, but I love you so much I'll give it to you. That's the grace of God. And so we need to have a revelation of God's grace, because we're so often we've tried doing it on our own religion, our own faith, our own strength. And it's only through the blood of Jesus Christ, the grace of God. So it says, grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. This week, make it your endeavor. Grow. I'm going to grow in the grace and knowledge of Jesus Christ. And I don't know where you are, but if you need grace, extra grace in your life, and we all need grace, don't we? With this grace just to walk through a tough time in our life, grace to go do some things, make some decisions, whatever it is, it will be God says, I've got you covered with more than enough. I'll be there for you to give you the strength you need. I'm going to comfort you. I'll build you up. Let me look at those four things. What was it in Titus? Which one was it? No, it was in 1 Peter. I'll perfect you, I'll confirm you, I'll strengthen you, and I'll establish you. Hear that from the word of the Lord today. He's going to restore and complete you. He's confirming you. He's supporting and strengthening you, and he will establish you. So, Lord, we come today bringing before you our things on our heart and mind. And I don't want it to just be where we heard a good little thing and leave. We're asking that we would encounter this grace today on our life, that we would appropriate it, receive it today. And we're asking for, you've already poured it out, so we already know it's available. It's just we say yes and amen. We just receive it. And today we receive what you bought and paid for on that cross for you, for us. What you bought and paid for, we want to receive it today. Pure heart, clean conscience, renewed mind. So Lord, I'm asking for the measure of just the grace of the Lord Jesus be upon your people. May grace and peace be multiplied to us. I know it's also scriptural. Think that you multiply the revelation of that grace. You multiply our ability to receive it. And we do. We receive it today, Lord. We say no to sin. We say no to temptation. We say no to the flesh and the devil. And we say yes to you, Lord Jesus Christ. You're our Lord. You're our Savior. You're our King. We will live for you. We will trust you. Lord, I'm asking for miracles to happen in this congregation. People will see your divine hand at work and know that it was you, and they'll have a testimony to share. Fill this place, Lord, with testimonies and praise reports. Well, we're dancing. We're singing because we have encountered a grace like never before to lift us up, to build us up. Let the people in this church be built up in the faith. Let them be mature, strong, on fire for you, passionate, just loving you so much. We thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit, that you do that in us. Thank you, Holy Spirit. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. Praise God. Oh, I thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We didn't get to the steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. That's 576 in the hymnal. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. If you need something in your life today, call upon his name. If you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, here's the day. Don't wait another day. Give him your life. You can be born again. The only one way to the Father. And you just repent of your sins. Say, Lord, I'm sorry. And he'll come in. He'll forgive you. 576. Steadfast love of the Lord never ever ceases. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning, new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness, O Lord. Great is thy faithfulness. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases, never, never. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning, new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness, O Lord. Great is thy faithfulness. The Lord bless you and keep you. Oh, thank you, Lord. May your people see it this week. May they see it happen in their life. Supernatural miracles from heaven. Abundant blessings increase, and they'll be able to strengthen their bodies, health in their bodies. Just amazing things happen this week in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Everybody says, Amen. Amen. We love you. God loves you. Give somebody a big hug today. And the birthday spankings, too. For the birthday. Thanks for watching online. We love you guys.